بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We thank Him upon all conditions. We send blessings upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household, his companions. May Allah bless them and bless every one of us. And bless you all and bless this beautiful city of Kano and its people and its surroundings and the nation. MashaAllah. Ameen, ameen, ameen. My brothers and sisters, I am delighted to be here. I'm sure you know that, right? You can see I'm feeling fresh, even though it's very, very hot outside. Inside here, it's a little bit cooler. But subhanAllah, it's more the warmth of the hearts of the people. And Kano is a place that I have fallen in love with a long time back. So I thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this beautiful gift of love for the sake of Allah. We have a very important topic that I will be discussing today, inshallah. And I want you to listen very carefully. But before I actually go into the topic, I want to tell you, they told me, you know, Sheikh, we have a problem. I said, what is the problem? They said, you know, the venues are all taken and the biggest venue is taken and we have a venue about half its size. I said, no problem, I can come twice. SubhanAllah. So it's a bonus. Imagine if you have a venue of 3,000 and you come once. If you have a venue of 1.5, how many times do you need to come? Twice. So you should have had a venue of 500. We would have ended up coming back 6 times. MashaAllah. May Allah bless you all and grant you ease. MashaAllah. Tabarakallah. We have many issues that need to be addressed, not only in Kano, but in Nigeria. In fact, not only in Nigeria, with many cultures across the globe, there are certain serious matters that need to be addressed. You see, we were created by Allah. We were created by Allah. Allah alone decides what we should and should not do. Allah is the one who gave us life, just like He gave everyone else the life. Sometimes the men think that they are the only ones who are fit to live and the women are not supposed to live. In some cultures, that is how they look at it, not here. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created men and women. Both of them should complement each other. Both of them should be there for each other. They should make life easy for each other. They both have an equality within a certain sense, and that is the sense of gaining closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, there are physical differences. That does not make them inferior in a complete sense or in any sense, in fact, because it's a give and take. People misinterpret religious script in order to mistreat and maltreat our women. And this is happening not only throughout Africa, but even in Asia, in India and Pakistan, Bangladesh, various other places, Southeast Asia, in the south as well of Asia. I've seen it happening in so many places I've traveled. People complain. People actually feel suicidal because of the way they are treated by the men. It's a fact. You know, a woman is a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And she is a creature of Allah. She is a daughter of someone. Why do you think the hadith never speaks about receiving Jannah to bring up boys? But it speaks about achieving Jannah to bring up and raise girls. Do you want to know why? Because in that sense, they are higher than the boys. You have to raise someone with so much love, so much of care you spend on them. You are so close to them and you have to give them up to someone else. So you get Jannatul Firdaus. When you lose a baby and or a child and they die, may Allah grant all of us Jannatul Firdaus and make it easy for those who've lost children. Say Ameen. When you lose a child, you receive a status by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you bear sabr, and if you are patient, and if you are a person who does not question Allah's decree, He tells you that I will grant you paradise because of your patience. Subhanallah. The child will fight your case on the day of judgment and intercede on your behalf. Oh Allah, you did not give my parents the chance to be with me during the life of the world. At least bring them in so we can be together here now, which is in Jannatul Firdaus. So there is a sense of intercession that will be taking place, but only by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. However, it is because the child that you loved, you cared for, you wanted to care for, you looked forward to, that child was not given the opportunity to be with you. They were taken away from you by Allah in the form of death. When it comes to a woman that you have brought up, a daughter, you raised your daughter, she played with you, you played with her, you gave her a good education perhaps, you gave her good morals and values, and one day someone else has to come and ask you, you know what, please can I marry your daughter? Wow. As much as you are excited, everyone says, I want my daughter to get married, right? Right? But then we don't want to give our daughters away sometimes. We make it tough. What do you have? That's a question everyone asks, isn't it? What do you have? Where are you from? Etc. Nowadays, wallahi, the biggest question, correct me if I'm wrong, is a question of wealth. Is it right?
Yes.
Whereas it's haram to make that a primary aim. Did you know that? I remember a time when there was, without taking names, you will know the person if I took the name. There was a man who was starting up in life, 19 years old, 20 years old. He went to propose for someone. Propose to get married. They threw him out like you can't believe. And guess what? He continued in life without those people, you know, to succeed. Allah did not want them to be a part of their success. It is unfair to look at a reasonable, responsible human being and to reject him simply because he doesn't have wealth. What is wealth? You will die tomorrow leaving it all behind, subhanallah. It is only a means of testing you. You can use your wealth to get Jannah, like a lot of people do, and you can use your wealth to get Jahannam, like a lot of people do. We don't want to mince our words. You watch the rich and famous. There are those who become closer to Allah, and there are those whom they become more distant from Allah through the same wealth. The same applies to your looks. Sometimes Allah made you very handsome, very pretty, etc. Some, they use all of that to thank Allah. They remain in ibadah. They gain Jannatul Firdaus through the ni'mah of Allah. And some, because of that gift, they go towards Jahannam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us utilize these gifts. And Allah gives it to you for a short space of time. You know, there is one problem we have across the globe. I'm not going to say Kano. I'm not going to say Nigeria. I'm not going to say the country. Throughout the globe, we want to compete with each other regarding the size of our marriages and weddings. Not the marriage, but the wedding. The size. How many people? 20,000 people in that wedding. Look, my brothers and sisters, not everyone is wealthy. Live exactly according to your means and set a trend where people can follow a good trend. Keep it simple, down to earth. There is greater blessing in that which is simple, simplicity. If you can afford something huge, no problem, but still keep it simple. And remember, there are people who are coming after you who are going to want to be like you. I know of a case where a simple family, a young girl, she was very good looking. When the proposal came, her father made a condition to the groom to be, that we need to have a wedding with X number of people at such and such a place, and we need to do this. And the boy is thinking, gosh, I haven't even moved forward, and you're already talking about what exactly you want. What is the whole purpose of this marriage? Are you selling your daughter? Or what is it that you're trying to do here? That should never be a point of discussion. Subhanallah, keep it simple. Abdurrahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu, he was the richest of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ at one stage. Do you know that? In his early life, he didn't even let the Prophet ﷺ know that he was getting married. Not that he didn't want to say it, but when the nikah is ready, you don't delay it. So he got the marriage done. When the mark of perfume, or there was a yellow mark on his clothes, it was seen by the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ says, what is this yellow mark? He says, tazawwajtu ya Rasulallah. I got married, O Messenger. How many of us, we would never speak to our friends if they didn't invite us to their marriages? Because we have lost focus from the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. We have lost focus, subhanallah. So let us go back and create simplicity in our lives. Some of the best proposals who will really look after your daughter are some of the simplest people who sometimes might take that child far away from where you live. but they will be extremely happy. And you know what? They will grow together. You know what? You don't need to have a million. Many of us, we will never see a million. Do you know that? Perhaps even with a few thousand, you will be very, very happy. Many of the women are struggling because they are married to wealthy men who are not really interested in them. The only thing he has is money, nothing else, nothing else. No character, no fear of Allah, no deen, no respect, no time spent, nothing. And you know what? It's pain upon pain, hurt upon hurt throughout your lives. Woe upon those parents who get their daughters married knowing that this man has nothing besides the wealth. Woe upon them. It's destruction. They have not fulfilled the duty unto Allah. We have another sickness. I don't know again about Kano, but I know about other places in the world. Child is born, they promise the brother or the sister, when the child grows, this child will marry your child. Brother, who are you to say that? Who are you to say that? You can say, you are my sister. It is very, very good if perhaps our kids might marry each other. Let's see when they grow older. That's the maximum you could do. But you cannot already say from the beginning, right, these two are together. And then that man, when he gets up, he could be a drunkard. He could be someone who is a womanizer. He could be filled with sickness. What type of sickness? Spiritual disease, no salah, no ibadah. But because I made the promise, that's it. There are some beautiful suitors who have come through. But you will say, no, I have promised the child. What are you talking about? You are promoting adultery and zina because those children will never be satisfied with that type of a man or a woman. I'm not saying it's not our dream to get our daughters, and I have 8 of them, mashallah. I'm not saying it's not our dream to get our daughters to, you know, marry people perhaps we think of in our minds. No. We all can have a dream, but you adjust your dream as times pass. You must adjust to reality. It's no harm to say, look, I wanted my daughter to marry your son, but I don't think it's practical anymore. Subhanallah. That's a real man. That's a real father. We need this guidance and guidelines because there is nobody guiding our men and sometimes our women. Parents in many cultures, unfortunately Muslims, they make it so difficult for the man to come and propose and to marry that they prefer to just commit adultery and carry on. Do you know that? Wallahi, so difficult. The boy comes in, you ask him a whole lot of 200 questions. 200 questions. إِذَا أَتَاكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ. Do you love the Prophet ﷺ? Do you really follow him, or do you just point at other countries? These people are no longer proper Muslims. Those people are no longer proper Muslims. Those people are no longer proper Muslims. What makes you and I proper Muslims? We haven't followed the Messenger ﷺ. We only do what suits us. Well, they are doing what suits them. So we have an ummah, large in number, but free. Or very little in real action according to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. He says, when a proposal comes to you, two things, if they are good, consider it and let it happen on condition that both of them want to do it. What are the two? Deen and khuluq, the level of deen. First thing you need to ask about salah, do you fulfill salah? You ask someone else, is this person, do they come to the masjid? That question no longer features in our list of questions. Am I right? Wallahi. Young man, he's so conscious of Allah. He might not have much. He's in the masjid. He does his Quran. You know, today I met young boys who are traveling with me and they are in da'wah. Brother, are you married? No. Brother, are you married? No. Brother, are you married? No. How? You know, people, they don't like to get their daughters married to some men who are involved in da'wah, because what is going to happen? They will think these people, perhaps they might not earn, and they might... Is that what you are getting your daughter married for? Wealth? No wonder the Naira is dropping so badly. May Allah forgive us. Yes, it's crashing. Stop looking at it, it will stop looking at you too. Subhanallah. The deen, first question. The deen. That's why the boys are suffering. They are old. They could be grandfathers, but they are still trying to get married. Allahu Akbar. Look, they are laughing because they know it's true. The hadith says, and that's our hadith of discussion today. The topic is very relevant. Seize opportunities before you lose them. Wallahi, seize the opportunities. The young age is not going to remain. When the man is a grandfather, you are now saying, right, come get married because you have earned your first billion. Relax. Subhanallah. When we were younger, the 1 million naira was really 1 million. Do you agree? Today, 1 million naira, even the guy on the street can have it. Yeah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. I feel sorry for a man who was told, when you get your first million, come and get the daughter. When he got his first million and came back, now the million was worth $100 or a little bit more. Now they are saying, it's not this, no more. But brother, he worked for it for a long, long time. Like the people who are saving up to go for Hajj. When they are told, okay, it's so many. By the time they save that, it's double. When they save that, it's triple. May Allah make it easy for us to go for Hajj. So my brothers and sisters, you look at the deen and then you look at the character. A person comes with such beautiful character. Yesterday and today, I met some people. I can tell you they were raised in a very good home. I can tell you that their character is outstanding. I can vouch for it, because you just watch how the people walk, how they talk, how they carry themselves is so attractive. You cannot believe it. They carry themselves with utmost dignity, but they're not married. Subhanallah. Why? Character means nothing anymore. You have to jingle the notes and flash all the currency. That's it. Your car, your watch, your perfume, the clothing. And you need to have a new set of clothing for every function. And by the way, a new set of makeup for every function. Allahu Akbar. May Allah make it easy for us. We have become superficial. We have become fake people. Wallahi. It's my duty to let you know. And I'm not saying it in a bad way. I'm just reminding you, it's good to love certain things. Everyone likes their clothing and the way they look and a little bit of this and that. But that should not determine, that should not determine your real value in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your value is with your deen, your closeness to Allah, your akhlaq. As for the rest of the things, wallahi, they will go. They will go. Everything you have is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They will go. So let's get to our hadith. The hadith that we are discussing today, a very, very interesting narration of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, wherein he says the Prophet ﷺ was advising a man. He was giving him giving a man advice. And he told him, you know what? Seize five opportunities before they are overtaken by five conditions. And they will all be overtaken by five conditions. When Allah gives you something, He is going to take it away. There's no chance that He's not going to take it away. If Allah gave you something, it is going to go. That's the plan of Allah. That already proves that while you have it, use it correctly. It's going to go. Subhanallah. While you have it, use it. It's going to go. So what does He say? Subhanallah. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned five items, and these five are part of the test of Allah. When Allah made you, He says, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have only created mankind and jinkind to do things the way I want them to be done. That's the meaning of it. I have only created mankind and jinkind to obey me, to worship me, which means to do what I have told them to do, to stay away from what I told them to stay away from. And wallahi, my brothers and sisters, if you do that, you will be content in this world. You will be happy in this world. You will smile even if you are living under a tree. And if you don't do that, you will be depressed even if you are living in a palace. Did you hear that? How many people are depressed? Sleeping pills don't work anymore, but they are living in palaces. They have beautiful mansions, but even the sleeping pills don't work. You know what's wrong? Your relationship with Allah is wrong. Something is missing. Your tawakkul, your trust on Allah. Your trust on Allah, something is wrong with it. Develop, change, do something, and Allah will open your doors. You will be content even if you are struggling with a terminal sickness. I meet a brother every time I go to Dubai. He is paralyzed totally from head to toe for the last more than decade. And he's always very happy. He cannot speak with his mouth. He actually, the movement of his eyes determines what he wants to say. It takes him half an hour to say one sentence, subhanallah. But he always says, I am very, very happy with what Allah has chosen for me. Subhanallah. A man who cannot move, telling you, I'm happy with what Allah has chosen for me. He is a man looking forward to the meeting with Allah. And as for us, we are looking forward to the meeting with someone we can commit haram with. That's what it is. We are looking forward to something that is material, that is going to go anyway. You know, the pleasures of this world, think about them. They are all very temporary, very temporary. The only thing that remains is your relationship with Allah. A person who committed adultery, how long was he satisfied for? A few minutes. A person who gambled and won a lottery, for example, how long was he happy for? Sure, go and Google those who have won big lotteries. Most of them depressed, a lot of them suicidal, some even committed suicide. But they won millions and billions. You know why? There was no Allah in that link. That's why. Those who have gone to the clubs, what did they gain? A little thing. For a short period of time, they felt good. After that, reality strikes, you become even more depressed. Those who resort to alcohol to solve their problems, instead of resorting to Allah to solve their problems, the alcohol makes them forget. I spoke to a Muslim brother, unfortunately, on intoxicants and drugs, and he told me, I've got too many problems. So I said, so you are adding to your problems. That's what you are doing. You are adding. Yes, every sniff or pull of weed is a problem. It's a big problem. One more pull. And now people are saying, but it's legalized. Legalized? What legalized? Subhanallah. In Islam, the rules will remain the same. Isn't alcohol legalized in many places? Does it make Islam change? No. Alcohol is legalized. Adultery is legalized. So many things are legalized where we who have chosen to be Muslims have chosen to be disciplined. We will follow what Allah says. Allah says, don't do it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen us. Brother, you can leave that tissue there, inshallah. Someone is bringing tissue. I can say, it's okay. We will sweat it out today. It's carnal. So my brothers and sisters, it's very interesting to see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a chance to prove ourselves. If I were to ask you how many of you would like to be billionaires here, I think I don't even want to say it because more hands would go up than a religious question. Right? But if I were to ask you, when you get a billion, what are you going to do? You will have embarrassing answers. Wallahi. You follow what I'm saying? Embarrassing answers. What we want to do, say, oh Allah, bless me with the millions, bless me with the billions, and prove to Allah that when I have it, let's see what I'm going to do. People are worried, that man has a lot of money. What is he doing? Go and see. He's doing a lot of good work. Subhanallah. He's doing a lot of good work. She's doing a lot of good work. What about you? The first 20 that you got in your pocket, it went into the wrong direction. Allah says, I'm not going to give you more. Because I know when I give you, look what you are doing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. You follow what we are saying? So, my brothers and sisters, let's work hard. Let's contribute to community. Let's contribute to society. We need to build. We need to build our morals and our values. We need to have a system whereby we take care of each other. Look after your wives. Look at her as the daughter of someone. You know, many of our wives, and I'm saying our wives because the majority of men, I'd like to think, astaghfirullah, forgive me if I'm wrong. Maybe Kanu's an exception, but I doubt it. Many of our wives, they suffer in silence. Is it right? The men are saying yes. How ironic. Subhanallah. They don't know where to go. This man is, number one, adulterous. Number two, they think because they have the money, they can go and do what they want. They drink alcohol, but they read salah at the same time. How is this happening? How? Allahu Akbar, you have wealth. Allah is watching you and He's going to take your wealth away. He'll take your happiness away. He'll inflict you with disease, with issues, with problems. How? When you have been blessed, respect others. Allah will give you respect. The Prophet says, the best from amongst you is not the best with the billion, not the best with the million, not the best with the best car and house. He's the one who can respect his wife and treat her with utmost respect and be kind and the best to her. That is the best of all men. Subhanallah. How many are good men here in Kanu? I see one hand at the back. Jazakallah khair, my brother. May Allah bless you. May Allah bless you. Try your best, honestly. Make it your own challenge. And my dear sisters, don't start developing a big head and say, did you hear what happened here? You heard what the Sheikh said. No. It's give and take. It's give and take. We also need to carry ourselves with respect. Look after the wealth of your spouse. Look after his dignity. And it should be mutual. It should be both ways. Subhanallah. We look after each other. We look after each other. And that's how it should be. Take care, but respect. You know, in the Quran, Allah has named an entire surah after a woman who complained about her husband to the Prophet ﷺ, and she was complaining actually to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قد سمع الله قول التي تجادلك في زوجها وتشتكي إلى الله والله يسمع تحاوركما. الله أكبر. She complained, the Prophet ﷺ was telling her to wait, to hang on, etc. And Allah revealed verses to say, Allah has heard this discussion between the two of you. Allah heard this woman who is coming to complain to Allah. She's talking to you, complaining to Allah about her condition. The husband doesn't sleep with her. That was the problem. Subhanallah. Imagine how embarrassing it is for a woman to go up to someone like the Prophet ﷺ and say, this man doesn't sleep with me. He considers me just like his own mother. A'udhu billah. It's so embarrassing, but it happened. It is mentioned in the Quran because we need to learn a lesson that to fulfill the rights of your spouse that are the base desire, that is absolutely your duty on both sides. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. I said, don't bring the tissue, but he still brought it. May Allah forgive you, my brother. Jazakallah khair. It's kanu. They do what we say, don't do. Allahu Akbar. It's okay, brother. I'm enjoying the heat. You know, people pay to go into a sauna. Wallahi. They pay money to go into a sauna. At least here we get it free of charge. No, alhamdulillah. That's one of the 5-star. It's a 6th star that you need to add. Say, free sauna. Allah bless you guys. I really don't mind. Honestly, it's not a deed. It's not an issue with me. May Allah bless you. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us certain things. Number one, and this is in no specific order, right? No specific order. He gave you your health. You know what? He's going to take it away. He's going to take it away. You are healthy. You can walk. A day will come, you won't be able to walk. A day will come, you are not healthy. Every one of us, we suffer some form of a flu, some form of a cough, some form of a sickness with our health through the year, once or twice. Right? Don't make like you can't, it doesn't happen. Am I right? Yes. Thank you. So it happens once or twice. It might not be a serious thing, but it's Allah showing you, you know what? Your health is so delicate. It's in our hands. If you're not going to rest properly, you're not going to do this properly. And sometimes even if you are so careful with your health, you still develop. Those who are so careful, sometimes they develop bigger sicknesses. It's Allah. And Allah is showing you, subhanallah, that you know what? This is a gift. We are going to take it away. It's temporary. It is very temporary, subhanallah. Your health is going to go away. So while you are healthy, what are you doing? Ask those who cannot read salah anymore standing. When they were healthy, did they read salah on it? Did they even read salah? That's a question. Did they fulfill their salah when they were okay? No, no. They were busy using all of that in something else. Allah says, well, we're going to take it away. And that's why there is an ayah in the Quran which says those who did not used to do sujood, those who did not prostrate to Allah, those who did not do salah in this world, on the day of judgment, they won't be able to do sujood to Allah in front of Him. يَوْمَ يُكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ وَيُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ فَلَا يَسْتَطِيعُونَ خَاشِعَةً أَبْصَارُهُمْ تَرْهَقُهُمْ ذِلَّةٌ وَقَدْ كَانُوا يُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ وَهُمْ سَالِمُونَ. They used to be called to sujood when they were healthy. They didn't do it. So on this day when Allah exposes part of Himself and they will be called to do sujood, their backs will be straightened and they won't be able to go down because they never ever did it. Subhanallah. I'm calling on you and on myself, my brothers and sisters. Don't be lazy to fulfill your salah. No matter what time of the night or day, your farad is something you should never let go of. Never let go of it. That which is compulsory, don't ever, ever miss it. May Allah forgive us. May Allah strengthen us. No matter what. I've been having questions of late, my brothers, my sisters, more so for the sisters. I need to tell you because it's a new problem. I've been having questions of late of people asking, and I thought it was a joke initially, but it's not. They say, I paid £150. You know what that is? A lot of money. How many naira is that? Can someone quickly work it out? 150 British pounds. How many naira is that today? 150,000 naira, perhaps. Perhaps, right? How many? You mean the rate is going up as we are talking? Allahu Akbar. May Allah forgive us. I hope that's not the case. But my brothers and sisters, whatever it is, it's a large amount, right? I spent 150 pounds on making up my face. Am I allowed to delay my salah? Wallahi, can I not just put some, you know, wash my face before I actually put on the makeup or the nail polish so that it can act as a leather sock, which we are allowed to do masah over? Because how can I attend the wedding? It's going to last from the time of Dhuhr or Asr all the way to 11 at night. How? Wallahi, my sister, you sold your relationship with Allah for 150 pounds. Allahu Akbar. That's what happened. You sold your relationship with Allah for 150 pounds. What was more important to you, your salah or your makeup? I'm not saying it's wrong to look good, no. But it depends what you are trying to do, and it depends if you are compromising your relationship with Allah, there is something wrong. A day will come when you will really regret what you did, subhanallah. You follow what I'm saying, my brothers, my sisters? And many are asking the question, no, it can't be. How can I lose so much of money? Another thing, some of them lose their health because they are holding the wudu. Holding your wudu, subhanallah. Wallahi, many years ago, there was a lady, I mentioned it in one of my talks long back. So she visited our house some time back and they were attending a wedding. And she was doing wudu and not finishing. So my mother noticed this. My mother thought maybe she's OCD. Perhaps she needs a little bit of help, guidance. My mother said, what's happening? She said, no, I'm making 10 wudu one time because, you know, if one breaks, at least the other 9 are there. Wallahi, this was ignorance. She really believed that that was the case. She really believed it. Subhanallah. And so my brothers and sisters, today we have a similar problem. It does not mean that because your makeup was extremely expensive that you have any discount regarding salah. No. And you know what? The less you use, the better you actually look. Let's go back to our natural looks. Be excited with how Allah has made you. Be proud of how Allah has made you. And inshallah, you will be very, very successful. On the other hand, we have men complaining about not being allowed to kiss a spouse just because that makeup again was 150 pounds. Subhanallah. The men, they know what I'm talking about, don't you? I see some unmarried men saying yes. May Allah forgive us. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. But my brothers and sisters, it's a reality. Learn to strike a balance for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Learn to know what your priorities are. One day it will be your last day. One day it will be your last opportunity. And that's the day if you didn't read salah, you won't be able to have done it. We always say, according to the Quran, there is a salah at the beginning of the day, it's known as Fajr. There is a salah at the end of the day, it's known as Isha. You started your day with prayer so that if you die during that day, you would have had a blessed day at least. You ended it at night with prayer, so if you died at night, you would have at least had a blessed death. Your day starts with prayer, it ends with prayer. If you don't die, you have a blessed sleep and you have a blessed day. And if you die, you have a blessed death either during the day or during the night. So you start your day with prayer. How many of us, we don't start our day with prayer unless we happen to not be able to sleep. It's a fact. It's a reality. Let's not lie. May Allah forgive us. Fill up the masajid. Cry to Allah. Fulfill your salah. See how your life changes. See how your condition around you will improve. You become a better person. Your morals, your values, yes. Learn to respect each other. I spoke about health. Your health is a gift of Allah. It's going to go one day. What are you doing while you are healthy? Are you using that time to do what pleases Allah? A time will come when that health will go. Many people are diagnosed diseases and sicknesses. If not, you get old and at the same time your health and everything goes at once. And this is why that hadith continues to mention other factors. Utilize your wealth before poverty overtakes you, my brothers and sisters. When you have money, understand, humble yourself for the sake of Allah. Humble yourself for the sake of Allah. Use it to
to earn paradise, how much are you going to need on earth? How much? How much? Not much. Make other people wealthy. Now that you are wealthy, subhanallah, by encouraging them, creating employment, perhaps some business, reaching out to them in one way, making them active, be happy when you see someone else earn. I know of some people, when they have a big business and they see another person open a tuck shop across the road, you know, you have a massive wholesale, massive, worth millions of dollars, and one man opens a tuck shop across the road, and we get so angry. Who is he to come and sell the cooking oil that I am selling at 1 cent less than mine? And so we get very angry, but we don't realize you can take a page from the Middle East sometimes, and perhaps from areas like these, where if there is one shop that sells mobile phones, the whole mall is full of mobile phones. If there is one shop that is selling abayas for the women, that whole area is selling abayas for women. People are happy. Your sustenance is with Allah. Prove your product, people will buy it, inshallah. And especially if you are a good person, Allah will send to you your sustenance. When you are giving others, Allah will give you to give them. So the money needs to come to you before it goes to them. Therefore, don't worry about the provision that Allah will provide you. He provides provision in a way that you will never ever believe. That is Allah. But use your wealth in a good way. Don't use it in a bad way. When you have wealth, don't waste it. And don't be miserly. Some are very wealthy, but they can't even spend a few dollars on their own wives and children. Is that not true? Wealthy, but you can't do something for your own wife, your own kids, your own family members. You can't do something. But when it comes to wasting, waste. You know what? Sometimes Allah does not accept people's wealth because maybe it is not clean enough. Maybe it is not clean enough. I know of a masjid project that was really at the doorstep of one very wealthy guy. He told him, no, you either put my name as the name of the masjid or I don't want to give you the money. Guess what happened? The project was contributed towards by the entire community, and they built an even better masjid, and it was now named independently from the man. When it was done, he came back, said, can I refund all those people who gave money? How? Who do you think you are? Allahul Musta'an. Allahul Musta'an. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not make us arrogant. Remain humble no matter who you are. No matter how much Allah has given you. Remain humble. Let's move on. The hadith says, utilize your young age before old age overtakes you. When you are young, use it in the right direction. It's a test from Allah. You are young, what are you going to do? You are active. Are you going to use your health and your young age to be productive, to get closer to Allah, or you are going to involve in sin? Allah says, yes, you want to do something, we will allow you to do it, but you need to regularize it. Yes, you will have your own spouse, you will have children, inshallah, if Allah wills. If Allah has not chosen something for you, like some of those who don't have children, remember, it's the biggest gift that Allah could bestow upon you. He will give you Jannah when you don't question Him. You can keep trying to have children, no problem. May Allah bless those who don't have children with good children. Say Ameen. Sometimes Allah shows people, you might get a child and then the child is such that you will say, I wish I didn't have the child. So Allah says, well, when we didn't give you, you were crying to us. So we gave you, now we gave you, you are still complaining to us. When are you going to be happy? When you didn't have, you were complaining. When you had, you are complaining. That's why some women, they never end up getting married, because Allah says, do you want to marry a prize idiot? Astaghfirullah, sorry to use that word. Do you want to marry a person who's going to cause depression and suicidal thoughts to you? Or would you just rather just remain alone for a while? It will be sad, but you actually surrender to what we have decided and dictated for you, and we will give you Jannah. Whatever you want, you will have there. Subhanallah. And don't be a depressed case. Well, who will I marry in Jannah if no one married me in the dunya? I had people ask those questions. Don't worry. When you go to Jannah, you tell Allah, oh Allah, you know, Allah says, kana ala rabbika wa'dan mas'ula. When Allah promises you Jannah, He says, you can ask Him about it. That, oh Allah, you promised us, give it to us. Subhanallah. You go to Allah and you say, oh Allah, you promised I could have whatever I wanted. I want this and this and this and this. As you are thinking, it will be given to you. Wow, 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 wow. Subhanallah. That is Jannatul Firdaus. فيها ما لا عين رأت ولا أذن سمعت ولا خطر على قلب بشر. Subhanallah. That which no one has thought of, no one has seen, no one has heard. It hasn't even crossed the hearts or minds of anyone. Allah says, we will give it to you. So don't worry. Jannatul Firdaus. How many were married and then widowed? Which might be even worse. But Allah says, you are a widow. Two things happen. People who take care of you can earn Jannah through looking after you for the sake of Allah and not for something material in return. Number two, if you bear patience, you will also get Jannatul Firdaus. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Those who are widowed, I'm sure there are many, many. It's a struggle. When you have children, it's a struggle. One of the hosts of this event today is a foundation known as Orphans and Women. Orphans and Women, if I'm not mistaken, Orphans and Women Support Foundation. If you haven't heard of them, they are the ones who made this possible today. And they deserve a little bit of recognition as well. Alhamdulillah. There are those who know the work. And there are so many organizations and foundations I have found doing a lot of good work. A lot of good work. All of them, we support them morally with our dua by mentioning them today here. We support all of those who are doing good work. A lot of good is happening. A lot. Please keep it going. My beloved boys and girls, become volunteers, get involved, go out and reach. Your young age is going to deplete and you don't want to have regrets later on that I didn't do this and I didn't do that. So go out, work for them, donate, give, see, participate, go and meet others, meet the underprivileged. Allah will help you to see how privileged you are. You know, before many years ago, when we didn't have bicycles, when I was a kid, I used to wish for a bicycle. One day I got a second-hand bicycle from someone who was now too big for that bike, a small little 20-inch bike, little one. And I was so excited, even though it was a dilapidated bike, riding and coming up and down the driveway and going here and there, we were excited. Anyway, as time passes, what happens to man? We went to university. In fact, when we went to high school, we used to catch a bus. And catching that bus, subhanallah, you know, when you want to come back home, you have to wait for the bus at 5 o'clock and it's 1 o'clock already. And you think, can I walk? If I walk, it's going to take me 2 hours. Anyway, you see cars passing one after the other. And you think to yourself, they don't even think, can I give a lift to this young boy? Right? You see people with nice cars, they'll even wave at you. And you say, I don't need to wait. I just need you to stop. I'll jump in. It costs you nothing, right? But no, it's Allah's way of teaching you. Subhanallah. So you are wishing for a car, any car. The day you get a car worth $500, a small little micra running around, whatever, whatever. To you it is Jannah, am I right? It's Jannatul Firdaus, I'm in my car, just jumping around, here and there. Subhanallah, you look at people until you see the Mercedes next door and you say, hey, my car is an embarrassment, subhanallah. Subhanallah. So you are now forgetting your humble beginnings and you are now focusing on something that you didn't really ask for. It was not in the picture at the time. You know, it's an amazing way people operate. It's the nature of man. So now from your car, you are now wondering, wishing for another car. Then you want to expand it. And if you didn't have a house and suddenly Allah blessed you to rent your own place, you don't care. Ask those women who are living in a big extended family, those families that are not easygoing. What this means is, Islam does not encourage you to live in a huge extended family where everyone is together and everyone needs to be at one place at one time, unless you are easygoing. Easygoing means give the people their independence. It's okay, you can make it, you cannot make it. Perhaps there is one important function, we will all attend it, then we won't. It happens across the globe. In my family too, we have a very large family, but now, less and less people are getting involved because the world is changing and people are preferring their individual independence rather than a collective intolerance. And sometimes it becomes so tough and so difficult that it tears apart a family within and above. It's just a fake good look, but inside there is real crying and real hurt. So what happens is, when you have a person who tells you, no, I don't care even if I live in a hut, but I don't want to live here. Are you following what I'm saying? I don't care even if I live in a hut, but I don't want to live here. When they get the hut, they are very excited, but just for a little while. Then what happens? You start missing your electric kettle. you start missing your hot water, you start missing everything. You say, this heart here, it's a bit tight in here, subhanallah. And then you want your own house. By the time you get your first own house, your own house, you don't mind how small it is or where it is, but for you, it's a huge achievement, only for a short time. You get your latest phone, the S10 Plus, 1 terabyte of space. You get that phone, and you know what? You are excited with it. You are very happy with it. But guess what? Just for a short space of time. Once the next one comes out, you are on edge once again. On edge once again. You want looking for more and more and more and more. In the interim, you lose focus from Allah. When you run behind the dunya always runs faster than you. Remember that. When you run behind the dunya, it will always run faster than you, no matter what. It's at a faster pace. You will never ever keep up, no matter who you are. Never. Ask those with wealth. They cannot keep up. And you know what will give them happiness? Getting closer to Allah, nothing more. You have your set of clothes. Some of the richest people who are close to Allah, they don't have too many clothes. They have their own sets of clothes and that's it. That's it. They are happy with it. They clothe others. They feed others. They give others. They are happy to serve others because Allah blessed them. Let that be the case. I always tell people, if you look in your wardrobe, my beloved sisters, if you have not used some pair of clothing for 1 year, give it away. Give it away. It will bring you into Jannah. Some of us have clothing. In fact, sell it if you want. If you need the money, sell it. If you don't need the money, give it. Let's see someone else in a set of clothing that made you very, very happy and give it to them. Subhanallah. I know of some sisters, maybe many, when they sew something for their wedding, they keep it for 30, 35 years in the cupboard. And when you say, why have you kept it? Perhaps one day I'll fit back into this. Subhanallah, you've given birth to 3, 4 children. You want to go back to your wedding clothes. Why don't you look at another bride and give it to her? If Allah has blessed you with daughters, they can have their own. They don't need to be in your clothing. What you wore when you married their father, perhaps, doesn't need to be. If you want, it's okay. But this is only a way of looking at things. Give it away. Yesterday, I was flying to Kano from Abuja on the common airline known as Max Air. At least they are on time usually. Alhamdulillah. There was a brother sitting next to me. He was a Christian. We got talking about life and various other things. He told me, in my wardrobe, I only have 4 or 5 sets of clothing. Every 6 months, I remove what I haven't worn. And I said, that's my preaching. That's what I've been teaching. But he never heard me. He's doing it on his own, with his own accord. Imagine, non-Muslims. That care for humanity is shown in your clothing. 6 months, I told you today 1 year, right? But he is saying 6 months. I look in, I say, this thing I didn't wear, give it away. What am I to do? I was studying the life of Mark Zuckerberg. And some of the others, including Bill Gates, they have very few pairs of clothes. Trust me. And they wear the same thing almost all the time. Why? They are focused on something else. May Allah help us focus on Jannatul Firdaus. Wallahi. Life is not about showing, proving. I know of cultures. Not only here. Trust me, it's not a problem only here. It's a problem across the globe. Where weddings today are becoming so big and so fancy. And everyone struggles. The amount of money that a community spends on a wedding goes into the billions because every person who attends wears a new set of clothing. No wonder there are so many people who are tailors today because that's a booming business, subhanallah. Booming business. Mashallah, we need a new set of clothing. How can I wear the same one that I wore last week? Oh, that's an embarrassment. Wallahi, you can. And why not? Why not? You are setting a trend that is dangerous. Our children will not be able to live it. They will have to steal to live it. They will have to do haram to live it. Let them utilize those resources in something more constructive. Not on this. Just go with something plain and simple. Look good. So what if you wore it so many times? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us forgiveness. We become such that we run behind these things. If Allah has blessed you with wealth, alhamdulillah, but you have a problem, you are setting a trend. The trend, be conscious. Others might not be able to afford it. I know in Europe and in other places, even in South Africa, and perhaps even here, people take bank loans in order to show a wedding bigger than what they can manage. For what? Have it simple, straightforward. Get a few people and that's it. I gave you the example of Abdurrahman ibn Auf. MashaAllah. If you can afford it, alhamdulillah. But like I said, be careful, you are setting a trend. Others will say, what type of a wedding is this? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, utilize your wealth before poverty overtakes you. How will poverty overtake you? A day will come when you won't have that money. And a day will come when you will die with the money and leave it behind. One of the two. Either Allah takes it away while you are alive, which has happened to many, or Allah takes you away and leaves the wealth behind. What did you achieve by it? What did you achieve? Did you deposit any of your money with Allah, or you just left it behind for your children to fight over? Your children to fight over. Sometimes this is what happens. People fight over the wealth left by their parents, and I wonder, but can't you do your own thing? Why are you worried about what your father left, what your mother left? I know of a case where one wealthy person came to me and told me, I have a problem with my son. Why? He told me, give me my inheritance now. Wallahi, can you imagine? And the father says, but I'm alive. He says, I don't care, alive or not, give it to me now. Hey, Allahu Akbar, give me my inheritance now. A'udhu billah. That statement, and wallahi, it's a fact. That statement is so dangerous. It goes to show how lazy we are. How sometimes we haven't even taught our children to earn a living, but we have. We haven't passed the baton on to the children. Be happy with what you have. Don't worry about others. Live in your capacity, even if people think that you are a wealthy person, but you know you are not. Some people, they dress well. From their dressing, everyone thinks, hey, they must be multimillionaires, but they are poorer than what you are who is talking. But they just know how to dress, that's all. Right? MashaAllah. You know, there was a man, another wealthy man, he was wearing a watch. I told him, you have a nice watch. Many years ago, you have a nice watch. He said, I bought it for 20 riyals in Makkah from one of the shops that sell things for nothing. I said, oh, that's interesting. He said, but when I sell it, I'll sell it for $4,000. I said, how? He said, people just offer me because they think as a rich man, I'll be wearing a very expensive watch. Imagine. Sorry, the wealthy here, I'm not giving you ideas. I'm only letting you know. When people look at something you have, they think, this must have costed 3,000-4,000. You know, I'll offer you 4. Okay, take it. May Allah forgive us. Look at how, you know, personally, I cannot tell a difference between a Chinese product and another product. I can't. Sometimes those look more smart than the other ones. I don't know if you know what I'm saying. What is it all about? I really don't know. And that's why now when you see an original Rolex, you look at it and say, is that from China? What? What? What did you just say? You have embarrassed me. No, I didn't. There are some in China that look better than this. And by the way, Chinese products are quite good, to be very fair. It only depends how much you are willing to pay. It's like the story of the fans. You know the story. Can I say it again? They say, you know, in China, they make the best products. A lot of what you have, original, like our phones, iPhones, Samsungs, whatever, many of the components are actually made in China. So people look at China and think, you know, but China, they base the product on how much you are prepared to pay for it. So if you want a watch worth $5, they'll make a $5 watch. You want a watch worth $500, they make a $500 watch, etc. Even the toys, some of them, you've only paid 1 naira for it. As soon as you do this, it breaks. They say, well, you paid one, you used it for one, you see. So what happened is, there was a miserly man. He was preparing for the wedding of his daughter. And the wife kept saying, what are you doing? The wedding is near. What are you doing? The wedding is near. One day when he was walking on the street, he saw a man on the side selling these fans. You know, they open the fan nicely and they actually have a fan that fans you. SubhanAllah. So he said, how much are these fans? He was told, it's 1 cent. No. 1 cent. So he said, these ones are 10 cents, these ones are a dollar, but these ones here, they are 1 cent. He said, give me 4 boxes. He got 4 big boxes. He said, right, let's take it home. He paid a little bit and it went home. When he went home, the next day, his wife told him, hey, listen, you know, I tried those fans. I opened one. As soon as I did this once, it broke. Then I opened another one. I did it once. It broke. He said, can't be. Those are proper fans. So he said, let's see. He opened one. He just did this. He went one time and it broke. He did it again. It broke. So he took the boxes. Let's go back to the man. He went back to the man. The man says, to the one man says to the other, you know what? I need to return these fans. There's something wrong with them. He says, no, what's wrong with them? He says, they are breaking. He said, how much did you pay for them? He said, I paid 1 cent each. He said, ah, did you read the instructions? He said, no. He said, if you paid 1 cent, there are different instructions for that fan. What are the instructions? This fan, look, read the instruction. Okay, open it. You opened it. Right, put it in front of your face. Put it. Now move your head. You're not supposed to move the fan. You paid 1 cent. You move your head. Subhanallah, Rabbil Alameen. Moral of the story is, you get a product based on how much you are prepared to pay for it. You want to pay 1 cent? You have to move your head. You want to pay 10 cents to a dollar? You can use the fan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. So my brothers and sisters, the same way, when we have wealth, what are we giving to Allah? Allah says He wants 2.5% in most cases. He wants 2.5% from us only. We find it so difficult to calculate that and to give it, yet there is no merit for a person who does only his farad except that he has fulfilled just the farad. It's like a person going for salah, they do the farad and walk out. What happens? Allah tells you, you want to gain real closeness, don't just do what is compulsory. Do more sunnah, nafila, etc. Then you will get close to us. You are healthy. Why do you want to run out of the masjid immediately? Why do you want to rush out of your salah quickly? Do more. If you do 12 units of sunnah through the day, you will get Jannah. So why don't you read some sunnah, salah, after your farad? The same applies to your wealth. You work out 2.5%, it works out to so much. You are saying, but I'm not liquid, you know, I owe. You know, the more you have, the more you are the 2.5% is going to be. I had a brother who once told me, I'm going to give 1% of my turnover to Allah. At that time, his turnover was 10,000. It got to 100,000, it got to 1 million, it got to 10 million. He came and asked me, you know what, do I still have to just give the 1%? Why? It's 1%. But because 1% of 10 million is no longer 1% of 10,000. Shaitan comes to you and says, maybe there's a way out. Give it, say 2% and move. Allah gave me more, I'll give more. When you had nothing, you were promising one. When you've got something, you want to chop from the one. How? It's the opposite. Look at this. That's why the hadith where the Prophet ﷺ says one man came with half a portion of dates, sadaqah. The people were laughing at him. The Prophet ﷺ says, in fact, Allah revealed verses. الَّذِينَ يَلْمِزُونَ الْمُطَّوِّعِينَ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ فِي الصَّدَقَاتِ وَالَّذِينَ لَا يَجِدُونَ إِلَّا جُهْدَهُمْ فَيَسْخَرُونَ مِنْهُمْ سَخِرَ اللَّهُ مِنْهُمْ وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. Allah says, those who are making a mockery of others, who are giving a small charity and that which their hands have earned, they are making a mockery of them. Allah will make a mockery of them. And for them will be a severe punishment. That man, he gave 50% of his earnings fi sabilillah, which translated as half a kilo of dates. You have not even given 1% of your earnings and you are laughing at him. You follow? Allah looks at your heart. Learn to give. Donate while you can. So I was telling you, my brothers and sisters, that we give only that which is necessary, 2.5% zakah. You really want to show closeness to Allah, give more than that. Your sadaqah, that which is for the sake of Allah, your voluntary charities, give them, give more for the sake of Allah. You will find a lot that you will get in return. Every day, put a few cents, put a few nairas into the box, every day. Is it hard? It's not. Allah will bless you. Start your day with a sadaqah. The Prophet ﷺ used to ask his companions at times, saying, Who has given a charity today? Who has visited a sick person today? Who has visited the elderly today? Who has read the Quran today? Who has done this today? The one man who always used to answer yes, yes, yes to all of the questions. What was his name? What was his name? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Abu Bakr, here fondly known as Abba, right? Am I right? We call them Abba. How many Abbas are there in this crowd? Put up your hand, Abu Bakr's. How many Abu Bakr's here? Wallahi, I'm seeing more than about 20, 30 here, subhanallah. Only in Nigeria, maybe only in West Africa. All these beautiful names, we have them and they are here. And everyone loves using those names. The rest of the world, we are moving on to exotic names that have less in meaning, but they sound like you are very modern, you know. I didn't understand at one stage when I first came here. What is your name? Amina. What is your name? Khadija. What is your name? Aisha. What is your name? Fatima. What is your name? Halima. What is your... And the same names over and over and over and over again. Now, I know its value. Don't lose that. Don't lose that. Subhanallah. May Allah bless you. I met a family, Muhammad Awwal, Muhammad Thani, Muhammad Thalith, Muhammad Rabi', Muhammad Khamis. Isn't that family here in Kano somewhere? Subhanallah. All the children, Muhammad, first, second, third, fourth, fifth. I said, Subhanallah. Then what happened? Where is Sadis? He said, no. Then we had Amina. MashaAllah. Look, Allah blessed you. Daughter after five sons. May Allah bless us all. So my brothers and sisters, that was Abu Bakr. His real name was not Abu Bakr, by the way. His real name was Abdullah. His name was Abdullah and his father was Uthman. So he was known as Abdullah ibn Uthman. But they used to call him Abu Bakr. It was just a kunya. It was just a kunya, meaning nickname given to him. Subhanallah. What a lovely person. One of my dreams is one day to spend some time with him in Jannah. We want to know more about these people. We want to know what is there. And we know a little bit, but Allah kept them so special, wallahi. He chose them to be companions. I now know some of the reasons why. If the Prophet ﷺ was here telling us in Kano not to do this, not to do that, we wouldn't listen to him. I don't think many of us would be prepared to listen. Because today, we are telling you what he said and still we don't want to listen. So it's better we are not Sahaba. If we were Sahaba, we would be an embarrassment. Wallahi. Do you follow what I'm saying? Imagine he comes and he says interest is haram. And you say, if you know the figures. That's what people would say. They say, don't have a big wedding. You say, you know, we have to show there that we are big people here. People will have something to say to the Prophet all the time. That's why we are not Sahaba. When I sat and thought, Ya Allah, you chose the people. Allah says, Allah chose the best of creation and He made him Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He chose the best of companions and made them the companions of Muhammad. We believe, Ahlus Sunnati wal Jama'ah, that afdalu man masha ala al-ardi ba'da al-anbiya, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, Abdullah ibn Uthman radiyallahu anhuma. We believe the best to tread the earth after the prophets of Allah was a man known as Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. He was known as Ibn Abi Quhafa. He was known as Abdullah ibn Uthman. What a great man. Allah says, we chose him to be the companion. But Allah didn't choose you and I. You know why? وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It is not a true believing male or a female. It is not for them. Once Allah and His Messenger have declared something, to have a choice in that regard. When you're a true believer, you know, if Allah said this, I have no choice, I have to do it. If Allah said, don't do this, I have no choice, I will not do it. If Allah said it's 5 salah, it's 5 salah. If Allah said it's 2.5% zakah, it's 2.5%. If Allah said do this, it's do that. If the Prophet ﷺ said this, it's that. Finished, it's over. That is a true believer. But with us, we have so many words of advice. Those whom Allah has blessed with a lot, they still start thinking, I'm not yet ready to do what Allah has allowed, or what Allah has dictated, or what Allah has said, or to abstain from what Allah has prohibited. I went to one country where those who go for Hajj are all very old people. So I asked them, why? They told me, the waiting list is very long. If you apply, it will take you 15 to 20 years for your name to come. Did you hear that? How long does it take in Nigeria? Not long, am I right? If you want to go this year, you can go this year, right? Thank Allah. Thank Allah. There are countries where they cannot go, even in South Africa. They have a short, small quota. And if you apply today, you might get through after 2 or 3 or maybe even 4 years. Subhanallah. Because there are too many people. Then you witness the people who go very old. You ask the young, would you like to go for Hajj? Many of them, I'm not yet ready. Why? You know. Do you have the wealth? Yes. Do you have the ability? Yes. It means Allah has decided you should go now. But I'm not ready. Why? Then they can't tell you, I want to still sin for a few more years before I go for Hajj. That's the true answer. But you are embarrassed to tell me. I'm not a fool. We can read between the lines. Why? You might never ever live to see another Hajj. You will die. How many of the people have died in their young age? Many. Nothing wrong, suddenly boom, dead. Nothing wrong, suddenly gone, dead. Subhanallah. My brothers and sisters, I have spoken beyond 1 hour, but I think I can carry on, right? I don't come to Kano every time. Although I've promised the brothers that inshallah I will. Bismillah. We said 1,500 we will have by 2. So we only have the first one. I will come after a few months again, inshallah. And the heat is keeping me going. You know, the longer you remain in the sauna, the healthier your skin. People ask you, what do you use on your face? Can I tell you? Nothing. Subhanallah. Besides sweat, what else? May Allah forgive us. I'm grateful to have been given the opportunity to clarify that. I don't use 150 pounds. My brothers and sisters, the blessing of Allah is with us always. The fact that we are sitting and listening to the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam telling us, watch the opportunities we have placed in front of you, use them. You are young, watch out, do good things before your young age goes and you become old and invalid and you won't be able to move and walk and suddenly you can't even walk properly. But if you used your young days correctly, you will always be able to thank Allah and be happy how you used your young days. That is why the hadith says that there are 7 types of people who will be granted the shade of Allah on the day of Qiyamah. VIP. You know what is VIP? Very important person. VIP in this dunya, alhamdulillah, they may not be VIPs in the akhirah. Famous people in this world, maybe they are not even famous in the heavens because they have no good deeds going up. Some people who are not famous in this world, they are very, very famous up there because they have deeds going up every day. You understand? It's up to us to do more so we can become famous there and we can be VIPs there as well. Who are the VIPs? There are many, many, a list of 7 all at once, and there are even more than 7. But the 7 mentioned in one hadith includes Shabun Nasha'a fi ibadatillahi ta'ala. A young boy or girl, you know, in Arabic language they use Shab. It doesn't refer only to a boy. They use it taghliban. If you know the Arabic language, they use that gender. But it refers to both. Like when they say Banu Adam, it means the sons of Adam. In actual fact, it means the children of Adam, male and female. So no one must come and say this is only for the males. No, it's for both. Anyone who in their young days, they grew up and used that energy in the obedience of Allah. When you are bubbling with energy so much that you think you are a big person, if people don't look at you, there's something wrong with them because you are doing things to make them look at you and they are still not looking at you, so you are irritated. Allah says, use that energy in the obedience of Allah. We will make you a VIP on the day of Qiyamah. Because why? You gave us the energy that you had at the beginning of the energy when it was at a peak. When it was at a peak. Subhanallah. Don't we feel encouraged to do something, inshallah? My brothers and sisters, those of us who have faltered, use your opportunity of life, as the hadith says, before death overtakes you. Use your opportunity of life before death overtakes you. What should you do in your life? Turn to Allah. Repent. Seek forgiveness every day. Ask Allah's forgiveness. We are human. We falter. We make mistakes. We commit sins knowingly, unknowingly. We commit minor sins. At times, some may commit major sin. We may fall into major sin. All of us. Remember, turn back to Allah. You are still alive. There is always hope. And never let shaitan make you think that Allah will not forgive you. That is a secret. It's amazing. Never let shaitan make you think Allah will not forgive you. He will forgive you. But if you have oppressed another human being, you have wronged your wife, you have wronged someone else, you have wronged your spouse, your husband, you have wronged perhaps whoever, then you need to seek forgiveness from them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us to seek forgiveness from one another. Backbiting, slander, etc. People say very bad things about us. Nowadays we have something known as social media. Social media has its positives and its negatives. It gives the opportunity for many people to hide behind the screen of a phone. If only you could see really what they looked like and who they were, you would actually turn a blind eye to their statements. Some of these people who utter terrible, bad words, they are people who don't even respect themselves. And we feel so bothered by the fact that they have said something negative about us. Don't worry. They will say negatives about you. They said negatives about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who was the best of creation. So who are you and who am I? If they spoke bad about the best of creation, they will speak even worse about you and I. They will accuse us because they are dirty minded. When you see a man and a woman talking to each other, they are not talking dirty. And if you think they are talking dirty, your mind is dirty. That's what it is. When you see something, you come home and you are doubting your spouse, there is something wrong with your own trust of yourself. That's why you are doubting your spouse. That's the reason. Those who trust themselves don't have trust issues with others. But those who have trust issues with others, one of two reasons. Either glaringly the person has done something wrong in front of your face, which is a reason why some people have trust issues, because I saw you openly commit this deed. Now you want me to trust you? So that is one reason why people have trust issues. But a bigger reason is because they don't trust themselves. When you don't trust yourself, and it happens to a lot of men, unfortunately, and some of the women, where you don't trust yourself. So that's why whenever you look at your own spouse, you start thinking things. Wallahi, that dirty mind needs to be washed. With what? Dhikrullah and Salah and Quran, and turn to Allah and leave things to in the hands of Allah. Allah will give you. Allah will grant you. Allah will open your doors. That's what will happen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us ease. And there is one more portion of this hadith that we need to talk about, subhanallah. We spoke about health. We spoke about wealth. We spoke about young age. We spoke about life. The last thing I want to speak about, and I told you I'm not giving it to you in the order of the hadith. Your free time, spare time, occupy yourself with something. When you are having some time at hand, free, don't just sit and decide we are going to play, you know, that which is futile. No. Do something constructive. Join a class. Join something. Yesterday I had the good opportunity of visiting Zainab. Zainab who had the ordeal in Saudi Arabia. She was arrested under false charges. Do you know the story? I had the opportunity to see her. One thing she said to me, which actually moved me. You know what she said? Imagine, I want you to imagine something. Imagine a person who's been arrested falsely, framed, put into a prison, almost waiting to be executed. Do you understand what I'm saying? Guess what she started doing? Memorizing the Quran. Subhanallah. She said, I started memorizing the Quran in prison. Allahu Akbar. Imagine the type of hope Allah instills in the hearts and minds. May that not happen to any one of us where we are falsely accused. Say Ameen. If you don't accuse others, you won't be accused. And if you are accused without accusing others, Allah will take you out of it. Look at how Allah took her out of it. The reason why I visited her was to draw inspiration for myself. Imagine, it could happen to anyone. We are inspired by the fact that so much positivity was beaming from a totally negative situation. Totally negative. Generally, I'm a positive person, but sometimes we are human beings. We feel a little bit low. It's normal, it's natural. Wallahi, when you start thinking, she said, I knew inside, I knew it from Allah, I just knew something, that I'm going to be released here. Imagine. And there wasn't even a chance. If you ask me, the systems are very, very unique in this matter. May Allah make it easy. May Allah grant us goodness. So my brothers and sisters, use your free time, no matter where it is, to do that which is good. Yusuf alayhi salam had a similar ordeal. He was imprisoned. And guess what happened? When he was imprisoned, he used the time to do da'wah. He used the time to talk to the others, to call them towards Allah, to remind them. And he did a lot of good. When they came out one day, they had to remember him. And one day he came out. Subhanallah. But he was imprisoned for a long time for nothing. He was totally innocent, accused. That's why we say those in prison are not necessarily guilty of the crimes that they were supposedly found guilty of having committed. Remember what I've said. You see someone in jail, perhaps, maybe or maybe not, you don't actually know. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us goodness. So these are the few words that I thought we would share with you today. I tried to speak about some of the matters that we definitely need to address within our societies and communities. I want to leave you by telling you, my fathers and my mothers, my brothers and my sisters, make it easy for your children to marry. That is my main request for you here. Make it easy for your children to marry. Let them marry spouses whom they are happy with. Let it be. If they are making a little mistake, you can guide them. If they are still insisting, let it happen. Look at the deen, look at the akhlaq. Inshallah, Allah will provide for them. Allah says it in the Quran, you don't have to look for a wealthy spouse. Allah says, if you looked at the right reasons, Allah will make them wealthy. إِن يَكُونُوا فُقَرَاءَ يُغْنِهِمُ اللَّهُ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. If they are poor, if they are not well-to-do, they are good people, responsible, etc., etc., but they are not wealthy. They are not wealthy. Allah says, Allah will provide for them from His virtue. He is the owner of wealth. Let your children be happy. We are in the 21st century. People are looking at us and thinking of how backdated we are. Not because we are Muslims, because we are clinging to certain elements of the culture that happen not to be in sync, not only with Islamic teachings, but with the values that we are living by and with the fact that we are in the modern world, my brothers and sisters. Technological advancement will never make us change Islam, but our culture, sometimes one or two things in there we will need to change. And by the way, culture is very, very important in the life of a Muslim and in the life of a human being, on condition that that culture does not contradict Islam. Wherever there are one or two things that contradict Islam, Islam comes first, your culture comes second. The rest of it, you can follow the culture to the T. So don't be mistaken and say, we are against culture. Not at all. We stand for culture. We believe in culture. The cultures are what make the people. The cultures are what make us recognize one another. But there are certain things that Islam takes precedence over when it comes to the culture. So this is why I have given you the piece of advice. And I really pray that Allah bless you and grant you goodness. And I pray for all those who made this possible. And if Allah gives us the life, perhaps we will meet again with a different topic. And we will speak on words of advice for the brothers and the sisters. Let us develop our relationship with Allah. Let us use the opportunities that Allah has blessed us with. And let us understand that when Allah gives you an opportunity, that opportunity needs to be seized. If you don't seize it, you will regret it. Something came to my mind, let me share it with you. There was a case where a good man proposed to a certain family to marry his daughter. They refused him. Another good person came, they refused him. They were looking for, I wonder, right? They were looking for an angel from heaven perhaps. So what happened is, after they refused two or three men, people stopped coming. That woman arrived at the age of 40, totally depressed, very sick, very, very uneasy. Her parents have died, everything else has gone, and she is so lonely and alone, and she curses her parents. You know why? The day the rizq came to the parents, they just turned it down. When a proposal comes to you, it is rizq from Allah. It's like a man walking into your shop and asking to buy something. Subhanallah, it's rizq from Allah. Consider it seriously. If it is not worth it, decline. If it is worth it, take it one step more. And you will, Allah will open the doors for you. But to close the door immediately, you are saying, Allah sent me this guy to come to ask for my daughter. Get out. How? Subhanallah. Do they use that word get out here in Kano? The boys are saying yes. They use the word get out in Kano. A'udhu billahi sami'il alimi minash shaitanir rajim. May Allah make it easy. So that was a good addition that I added. I was unaware that it happens. Please consider. And my brothers, be responsible. Don't just say, right, you heard what Sheikh said, I'm coming to propose and you will not tell me to get out, but you have no job, you have no nothing, you don't want to, there is no responsibility, you are on the street every day, you have no good standing, you are never in the masjid, you have no good character, and still you say, ah, but why are you saying no? I have every reason to say no. I'm worried about my daughter. Please, I love her. I wanted to marry someone respectable. So please be someone respectable and then you can go forth. May Allah open your doors. Aqulu qawli hadha. I enjoyed myself speaking here today in the heat with the sweat. I refused the fan and I refused the tissue because you know what? I enjoyed the sauna. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you all. Aqulu qawli hadha. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabina Muhammad.